Welcome to our online worship presentation for Green Valley Evangelical Lutheran Church. We're glad that you could join us today. You can follow along with the service by hitting the service button. It will put up a PDF copy of the service. On the other side, underneath the screen, is the sermon. You can look at the printed version of today's sermon. And right in the middle, there's a donate button. You can donate to the Lord's work through the ministry of Green Valley Evangelical Lutheran Church. We're glad that you are with us today. We sing the first hymn. Praise the Lord from the heaven. Praise the Lord from the earth. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. This morning we rejoice to worship our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins. And trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, before the suffering and death of your one and only Son, you revealed his glory on the holy mountain. Grant that we who bear his cross on earth may behold by faith the light of his heavenly glory, and so be changed into his likeness through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The word from God's prophet is recorded in 2 Kings chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. Elijah is taken to heaven. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord lives and you live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha replied, "but do not speak of it." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, Elisha. The Lord has sent me to Jericho." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and you live, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. The company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," he replied, "but do not speak of it." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to the Jordan." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So the two of them walked on. 50 men of the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you?" "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet if you see me when I am taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them. And Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel." And Elisha saw him no more. This is the word from God's prophet. The psalm for the day is Psalm 148. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights above. Praise him, all you angels. Praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you waters above the skies. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for at his command they were created, and he established them forever and ever. He issued a decree that will never pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures and all ocean depths. Lightning and hail, snow and clouds, stormy winds that do his bidding. You mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, small creatures and flying birds, kings of the earth and all nations, you princes and all rulers on earth, young men and women, old men and children. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. And he has raised up for his people a horn, the praise of all his faithful servants of Israel, the people close to his heart. Praise the Lord. This is the psalm for today. The word from God's apostle is recorded in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning at verse 12. Transformed into Christ's glorious likeness. Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. But their minds were made dull, for to this day the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. It has not been removed, because only in Christ is it taken away. Even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we, who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. This is the word from God's apostle. The word from God's Son, the gospel, is recorded in Mark chapter 9, beginning at verse 2, the transfiguration of Jesus. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them. And a voice came from the cloud, "This is my Son whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of our Lord. We confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We sing the hymn of the day. I bring you a message of grace and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God before us today is the gospel lesson, Mark chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. As you heard it read previously, it'll be repeated during the course of the sermon. I'd emphasize this verse. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud. This is my Son whom I love. Listen to him. This is the word of our Lord. Dear friends in Christ, I think I have had the most enviable career among my classmates from the seminary. I vicared, did my student preaching in North Hollywood. And for a hick kid from Minnesota, boy, what could be more glorious? It must be even ritzier than Hollywood, because it's a suburb. One of my relatives mused, "You lucky devil." Obviously, they had never seen gritty Sunset Boulevard and even grittier Lancashire. And then I got to spend most of my days in Viva Las Vegas. What can I say? I hear they fund the churches out there with a tenth of the casino winnings from their members. You can see why I don't make many trips back to attend alumni meetings. They got northern Wisconsin, Exonia, and Genera, Ohio. The lucky ones get a church in Milwaukee. But in all seriousness, we as Christians have the most glorious lot in life. We have the Lord of glory as our Savior. We have the testimony from the Almighty Father, given not once, but twice, in glowing approval of His Son. We've got the Holy Spirit, the Lord of life, touching us in our hearts daily. Universal Studios could only make it look like Charlton Heston split the Red Sea with their quick special effects drains, glass sides, and narrow camera angles. Our God really did part the Red Sea. And today we have a particularly glorious portion of Scripture before us, the Transfiguration of Jesus. And I could go on and on and on about the glory and the majesty displayed on the holy mountain, but I'd be missing the point. Here's the point. Listen to Jesus. Listen to Jesus. He is God the Son. He is approved by God the Father. He is our Savior. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. All through Jesus' ministry, he had proven time and time again that he was God the Son, sent by God the Father to do God the Father's will. He taught with authority. Even the guards sent by his enemies to arrest him said, "No man has ever spoken like this." And they weren't just using that as an excuse as to why they hadn't brought Jesus back in chains. His words had struck them. Just as certainly as Jesus' words in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Who are you looking for?" "Jesus of Nazareth." "I am he," would knock the temple guards and their gang to the ground. We have the words of grace and truth from his lips. Truly he is the Word. His miracles prove that Jesus was the Son of God. When the imprisoned John the Baptist was trying to get rid of his hold on to the bitter end followers, trying to get them to sign on with Jesus, he sent a delegation of them to Jesus to ask, "Are you the one who was to come? Or should we expect someone else?" And they arrive on a day in Jesus' life that was filled with miracles, so filled with miracles that Jesus could say, "Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind see, the lame walk, those with leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor. Blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me." He could say that because it was all going on before their eyes. The religious leaders feared the Romans would remove them from power if the nation followed after Jesus because of all the miracles he was doing. Jesus raises Lazarus, and they plot to kill Jesus and Lazarus. The miracles Jesus performed were real. Even his enemies recognized that and reacted to them. The prophets of old, they performed miracles. It was one of the signs they were sent by God. Granted, no one had ever done so many miracles in such a concentrated fashion as Jesus had, but what if he was just one of the latest and greatest of the prophets? One miracle could prove Jesus was the Son of God. Jesus did one miracle only God could do. God alone holds the power over life and death. "My times are in your hands," the psalmist says. Jesus promised he would raise himself from the dead. "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up again." No man could do that. Jesus did that on Easter Sunday. The miracles prove Jesus is the Son of God. But Jesus doesn't look like God. Taking a hint from Jesus riding that Palm Sunday donkey colt so small that no one had ever thought about riding upon it, Jesus could easily make weight to wrestle in one of the two lower weight divisions in high school. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him, Isaiah predicted. Isn't that just like sinful human beings? We dismiss a busload of evidence because we're looking for a Hertz rental truck. Jesus said, "Go and make disciples of all nations," and we refuse to listen. Where does it say in the Bible that we should baptize babies? "I and the Father are one," Jesus says. "The Bible never uses the word Trinity," an unbeliever comments as he bombs a church Facebook page. "Never will I leave you. Never will I forsake you," God promises us. Yet some days we feel so alone. If I were God, I would have said, "That's it. I've more than proved my case. Fiddlesticks on you." And then I would have walked away and maybe watched some fantastic fireworks as two black holes collided and swallowed up three entire lifeless galaxies at the edge of outer space. But that's not our God. He gave us the transfiguration of Jesus to remove that one last objection. Jesus doesn't look like God. Now on the Mount of Transfiguration, he does. Jesus gleamed. The brightness, it wasn't from a scrubbed face or $1 million smile. No laundry detergent could make Jesus' clothes that white. Even after a climb up, a sweaty climb up the mountain, Jesus gleamed. The light was coming from Jesus. He was giving us a glimpse of his heavenly glory. He is the Son of God. That's why we should listen to Jesus. Listen to Jesus. He is approved by God the Father. We don't like to take anybody's word, vouching for themselves. That's why every job application asks for references, and by references, they mean what somebody else thinks about you. This is what God the Father thinks about Jesus. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my Son whom I love, listen to him." Suddenly they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. Only God speaks from the clouds. He did at Mount Sinai with clouds and fire and lightning. He rides upon the clouds, the Psalms say. He comes down to judge in clouds and thick darkness, the prophets tell us. And God doesn't do this just to make an entrance. That's the way God is. No man can see my face and live, he tells Moses. So of course, when he makes an appearance revealing his glory, people notice. Of course, they react. And most of the time, that reaction is fear. A sense of dread seized Abraham, even in a vision, when God cut a covenant with him. God speaks. We listen. It's that simple. God the Father speaks. God the Father speaks from the cloud. God the Father says Jesus is God the Son in an approving way, as only a loving father can claim his son he is so, so proud of. And if you need more proof than Jesus raising himself from the dead that Jesus is God the Son, here's the proof. And if we can't infer it from God the Father's approving acknowledgement of Jesus as his son, God the Father comes right out and says it. He loves Jesus, whom I love. Now, on earth, we can love someone, but not particularly like them on a certain day. Love can be strained. Love needs to be rekindled sometimes. Hey, are you listening to me, guys? Today, Sunday, is Valentine's Day. February 14. You don't have football to take up your afternoon and evening anymore. There's still time to sneak out of the house and get her something. Anything. Don't forget her. But the love God the Father has for God the Son, the love each person of the Trinity has for each other, I can't even describe it. It's an infinite love, a mystical love. Compare aluminum foil to a skyscraper steel girder. That would be too small a comparison to putting our love for another human being compared to the love God the Father has for God the Son. God loves all of us, but God is talking about a special love, a one-of-a-kind love that God the Father has for the one and only God the Son. I am going to pay attention to the one God the Father loves like that. Aren't you? Yes, God is powerful, majestic, awesome. He is a great big God. But none of that matters at this point. The whole purpose of God the Father's appearing is that we listen to Jesus. Jesus is God the Son. Jesus is the one loved by God the Father in a one and only kind of way. Listen to Jesus. Here's the last reason we're commanded to listen to Jesus. He is our Savior. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Moses and Elijah are the two leading figures in the Old Testament. Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt and wrote the first five books of the Bible. Elijah was one of the greatest miracle-working prophets in the time of the kings. God showed the outsized significance these two men had in his plans by taking their bodies to heaven. Elijah never died. He went to heaven in the fiery chariot. Moses' body never saw decay. The Lord took it to heaven and reunited it with Moses' soul. They stand for the Old Testament. And the message of the Old Testament was that the Savior was coming. Philip tells Nathanael, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law and about whom the prophets also wrote." Jesus educates his two disciples on their way to Emmaus that afternoon of Easter Sunday, beginning with Moses and all the prophets. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? So when Moses and Elijah appear on the Mount of Transfiguration, they are talking about Jesus fulfilling God's plan of salvation. They were talking to Jesus about his upcoming sufferings, death, and resurrection in Jerusalem. We would listen to the Son of God. We know which side our bread is buttered on. We would listen to someone approved by God the Father. There's no greater celebrity testimony than that. But would not even the dullest among us, would not even the most self-centered among us, listen to the one who saved us? There's a line in a Broadway song that the girl is not interested in the boy going on and on about his past love problems, because I am yet to be in it. Fair enough. Let's talk about you. And remember, when I say you, I also include myself. You were born trailing stardust. Your first parents were godlike in their wisdom and holiness. They lacked nothing. Yet they chose to rebel against God and set themselves up as the highest good. They turned away from their Creator. Your stardust turned to sand. Every time you lied to each other, whether it was little lies that you were busy on a Saturday night because you didn't want to hurt his feelings, or the big lies that you were working late on a Tuesday night because you did not want to hurt your bank account in the divorce settlement. You even instituted a system of government that trusted no one, that had not two, but three branches of government to look over each other's shoulders to keep each other in line. And you took pride in that. You dreaded a king because absolute power corrupts absolutely. You knew this because you secretly lusted for absolute power and all the things you could seize and enjoy. Yet you condemned it when you saw that inclination in others. Instead of using a mirror to show yourself your faults, you used a magnifying glass on others for their faults. Your sand turned to stone, cold, lifeless stone. All you got to do is go to the cemetery to see it. Where are those ambitions now among the rows of marble tombstones? Where are all those desires now among the ranks of granite monuments? And you did it generation after generation after generation until it was normalized. You expected it. You accommodated it. You glorified it. You took credit for every good thing that happened, and you kept your mouth shut over every bad thing that you caused. You wrote God out of the picture. You didn't need him. Yet God sent his Son in the likeness of a human being, and being found in very fashion a human being, the Son of God lived among us. He told us the way to heaven. He loved us and gave us his time, his energy, his all. He healed so many of us. He lifted us up to heights we never dared to imagine. He destroyed the one who held the power over death, that is the devil. He took away the punishment we deserved when he died on the cross. The Lord of glory laid down his life on that God-forsaken tree. He did it for you. He did it so you could claim your rightful place in heaven, the place God always intended for you to hold from even before the creation of the world. Jesus did this so you would shine like one of the brightest stars in the heavens. I know. I know you will listen to Jesus. He is God the Son. He is approved by God the Father. He is our Savior. So yes, we are destined for glory. We have a crown of glory awaiting us in heaven, which the Lord our Savior will give not only to us, but to all who long for his glorious appearing. And yes, there is a glory that already surrounds us now as we all reflect the Lord's glory and are transformed in his likeness in our daily lives of godly living. That will come. That will be. Listen to Jesus. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Join your hearts with mine as we pray the prayer from the church and the Lord's Prayer. Lord God, maker and preserver of all, we praise and thank you for all you give us day after day. We are not worthy of the mercies you show us. May the word we have heard take root in our hearts and bear fruit in our lives. And may it encourage us to shine as lights in this sinful world. Heavenly Father, protect us from every kind of danger, sudden catastrophe, terrors of crime, the pain of disease, and the perils of the devil. Heal those who are sick, cheer those who are sad, Calm those who are confused, and give comfort to all who are old and infirm. Bless our land, our people, and those who hold offices of high trust. Keep our government and schools upright and strong for the advancement of good citizenship and useful vocations, that we may enjoy your gifts of peace, security, and well-being. Grant your blessing to every nation on earth. Where there are wars, let there be peace. Where there is hatred, let it be healed. Where there is poverty, danger, and disaster, come with your almighty power to help and restore. Protect those who travel by land, sea, and air. We pray especially that you keep our loved ones from whatever perils may threaten them. Bless those who serve you at this place. Give them a rich measure of patience, wisdom, and love. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. We bring all these requests before you, dear Lord, and ask you to hear us. But above all, we give ourselves to you, that we may serve you in whatever way is pleasing in your sight. Take what we have, gracious God, our bodies and minds, our time and skills, our possessions and offerings, and use them to your glory. We ask this for Jesus' sake. In his name we are confident to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We have our hymn response.
So we wait.
Please join your hearts with mine in the closing prayer. Blessed Lord, you have given us your holy scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We sing the closing hymn. Thanks for watching our worship presentation from Green Valley Evangelical Lutheran Church this Sunday. Remember, you can donate to the Lord's ministry carried out through the work of Green Valley Evangelical Lutheran Church by hitting that donate button that's just below the view screen on our website. This Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, and we are going to have a worship service to commemorate it. It will be Wednesday, 7 o'clock. In the evening, okay? The theme is be reconciled to God. Because of COVID precautions, we're not going to have the imposition of ashes, but we'll sing some of those powerful Lenten hymns and hear that wonderful message of God's invitation to come to Him, especially during the season of Lent. Then we've got our online, on-demand adult Bible class, Sunday adult Bible class, Luther's Large Catechism. It consists of a introduction, a YouTube introduction to the material, a hard copy, reading of it, interacting with the discussion questions, and then you can go to the subpage on our Facebook page for discussion, questions, interaction with the class participants. Let us know if you want to be involved and we can get you invited onto that discussion page. That's about it for now. Keep praying. Keep praying that we get this virus under control, that lots and lots of people get vaccinated so we can put this sorry chapter of the health of America behind us. Stay safe. See you soon.